You all did well. That's very good. Our scripture this morning is taken from the 22nd chapter of the Gospel of Matthew. If you were here, not last Sunday, because you weren't here, nor was I, but the Sunday before that, we read some of this very same passage. You'll understand why in just a moment, why we'll be picking it up from where we left off at that point. Matthew chapter 22, verse 34 following. But when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. Then one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question, testing him and saying, "Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law?" Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and the great commandment." That's where we stopped last Sunday, I believe. The second is like it. "You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." These words from the lips of Jesus himself. Most of you were here on the Sunday several weeks ago when Eddie Heath stood here and shared with us what he called the five characteristics of a healthy, growing church. He based his sermon on what he had experienced in 30 years of working for Virginia Baptist, 25 years in working and visiting in over 300 churches. And he gave us those five characteristics of churches of what makes for what I would call a good church, a great church. And the first of those is that a church that's shining for the Lord loves God unconditionally, the members of it. The second thing he said was that when a church is healthy and growing, the people will love those in and outside of the church. His third characteristic, which we'll look at next Sunday, was that in a healthy, growing church, the church members trust one another. His fourth characteristic, and I'm really looking forward to doing this one, he said a healthy, growing church is a happy church. And we might spend a whole hour that Sunday just being happy. And the last one, of course, was that a healthy, growing church was a generous church. After hearing Eddie preach that sermon, I decided on my own that what he shared was so significant that each of those 5 points was worthy of a greater emphasis. And so I decided then that I would take those 5 statements that he shared with us that day and devote an entire sermon to each one. And I shared this idea with him, and he encouraged me in it and thought it was just a wonderful, wonderful idea. In fact, he wants a copy of what I have said when I get through with what I'm going to say. If ever I get through, Sister Brooks, then I will do that. But anyway, we took number one in that Sunday 2 weeks ago, and I talked about that in a healthy, growing church. The people love God unconditionally. And Eddie made a statement during that sermon that I think needs to be repeated and expanded upon and perhaps explained a little bit. He said, "Every church I've ever been in felt that they were a loving church." Now, I may be a little bit skeptical, but I somehow believe if he's been in 300 churches, that not all 300 of them are truly loving churches, where the people love God unconditionally and love God in a similar way also. And so he gave some examples of that. I gave you some examples of that. When we love God unconditionally, it means that he's first in our lives. We really want to serve and honor him in a very, very special way. And I said during the course of that sermon, if you were here, that you cannot love God unconditionally and ignore his son Jesus, who is the Savior of the world. Loving God unconditionally begins with our acceptance of him into our hearts and lives. And then I mentioned two other things. When we love God unconditionally, then we will love a lost world for which he gave his life as the Savior. And I said a third thing, when we love God unconditionally, then we will, listen to this, we will love what he loved, and he loved his church so much he gave his life for it. And so that was my expansion upon what Eddie Heath said when he said that one of the first characteristics of a healthy growing church is that the people who make up that church truly love God. Which brings us then to number two. In the characteristics of a church that is healthy and strong. In fact, we saw, let me say just a word about love illustrated. And I shared this in the message, and it bears repeating here this morning. Many, many years ago, I came across the statement that has stayed for me for many, many years. And the statement was this: Jesus cannot be, he must be in one of two places in our lives. If he's not in our hearts, then he's under our feet, period. And so the decision we make, if we ask ourselves this morning, do I love God unconditionally? We simply ask, is Jesus really in my heart today by personal acceptance of him? And if he's not, the sad news is he's under our feet. Which brings us this morning to the second characteristics of a healthy growing church. This is what Brother Heath said to us that morning. He said, in a healthy growing church, the people love those in and outside of the church. Now, I mentioned the fact that Eddie told us that in his association with over 300 churches, and he's been in more churches than that, but in his association with over 300 churches, every one of them would say that they were a loving church, right? If I'd ask you this morning, do you feel, do you believe in your heart of hearts that Cobham Park Baptist Church is a loving church? All right. Every church feels that way, and they ought to feel that way. The problem at this point is that there are some churches that simply do not come up to that standard. And that's very evident. And some of you may have been in some or one where that was the case. And the evidence of this is that in some churches there are those who are critical and judgmental about everything that goes on in the church. Whether it be that the children are not behaving, or the choir sings off key, or, you know, the preacher preaches too long. Thank you. Or whatever, you know. But there's always someone who has reason for judgment or criticism of what goes on in the church. And the second characteristic is of the fact that not all churches are loving churches is because there are those who bring their negative attitudes with them to the church. And those with negative attitudes simply, it doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter what it is. But they simply disagree with what's happening or what's going to happen or what's being proposed. Perhaps you heard the story of the time, one time, of the preacher who asked all who wanted to go to heaven to stand up. And everybody stood up except one man in the congregation. He was sitting on the front row, probably right there where Jim is sitting. And so the preacher said, maybe I made a mistake. Everybody wants to go to heaven. Stand up. Everybody stood up beside him. And so he asked the man, don't you want to go to heaven? He said, yeah, I want to go, but I thought you was getting up a load for today. And so there's some people that just have a sort of a negative approach to everything that goes on in the church. A third characteristic to prove that not all churches are loving churches And I've seen this happen. There are churches in which some of those who make up the church simply will not speak to one another in the church. And when that exists, when that happens, then how can that church qualify as being a church that is truly a loving church? And I have proof of this one. I'm older than Eddie Heath. You would never know that. I mean, only difference between it, he has hair and I have brains. And so, but I'm older than, I've been around longer than Eddie Heath has. You understand that. And what I'm about to share with you is a true story that must have happened to me more than 50 years ago. You need to keep that in mind. I'd been asked to preach in revival services in a rural area of eastern North Carolina. Now, if you're from North Carolina, everything east down there is almost rural. And so, but anyway, that has nothing to do with it. But I was asked to preach in revival services in eastern North Carolina. Now, the pastor was a seminary buddy who had two churches in a close-knit community, and he was the pastor of both churches. And that still happens in our day. And he asked me to come down and spend the 2 weeks there. I would preach in one church, preach in Sunday morning to conclude that week, start up on Sunday night, and preach in the second church. He said, now, I must tell you this before you come here. He said, we have a man in one of those churches who has simply caused a whole lot of problem in that church. You need to be aware of that, and you deal with it as best you can. I said, okay. He said, in fact, he may even request a personal visit with you while he's here. I said, that's okay. I'll tiptoe through the two lips and do the best I can. So the time came for the revival services. I went. Oh, by the way, in that area of North Carolina, the lodging situation was kind of limited, if you get my drift, which means they didn't have we keep the light on or days in. Nothing was there. So they had me staying with this elderly woman who was a member of one of the churches. And that was all right. Because every night after service, I mean, we'd have coffee and pie or cake or something like that. And so it worked out fine. But during my visit there, she shared with me the very same story that the pastor had shared with me. There was a man in one of the churches that had caused problems for years and years and years. And he was still there. I said, all right. So as the pastor had warned during the course of that first week, the man called me up and said, Pastor, I'd like to talk to you while you're here. That's fine. I'll be glad to meet with you. And so we set the meeting up. I was to go to his house, which I did. And he shared with me some of his concerns. And, of course, I was hearing one side of the story. And so I didn't make a lot of ripple about it or anything. But after he had said what he wanted to say, I simply said to him, why don't we pray about this matter and pray that God will give us, in the concluding services while I'm here, give us some wonderful service. He agreed to that. Now, keep in mind, the story that I'm telling you happened more than 50 years ago. I can close my eyes this morning and see it. It was so vivid. I said to the man, I said, if we're going to pray, why don't we kneel while we pray? He said, that's fine with me. We knelt in that man's living room, him over here and me over here. I said, you want to begin the prayer, you want to close the prayer? He said, you go ahead and begin the prayer and I'll close the prayer. That was fine with me. And so I don't know exactly what I said, but I do remember one thing I said. During the course of my prayer, I prayed these words, God, if there is anything in my life that is interfering with the progress of this revival, will you show it to me so that I might confess it and get it straight so that we can have some wonderful services before the week is over? Amen. He prayed his prayer. This is a direct quote, 50 years old. This is the way the man prayed. Lord, if there's anything in this preacher's life that's holding up this revival, then let him know so that we can have some good revival services from here on. That is the honest truth. You see, people in this for whatever the reason, maybe, Gene, there's a psychological or psychiatric explanation, they can never see the problem that they may be the cause of. And so, if this be the case, then how can there ever be love prevailing in a church situation such as that? And so, in this situation that we're talking about, we see that a church can never be the radiant, dynamic, happy fellowship that it ought to be until the people, no matter who, what, when, where, or how, in that fellowship, love one another in the Lord. Amen. Now, that's half of what Eddie Heath shared with us. He said in a healthy, radiant, or whatever kind of church, they not only love the Lord, but the people love those in and outside of the church. Now this, I've spent 15 years with you. This is an analysis. I think we do a good job of loving one another. I'll share that with you. We do. That's not to say we're 100% perfect, you know. I mean, I have my problems with Jimmy Sanders. I'll tell you that right now. I have my problems with him. But we handle it okay, you understand. I'm just kidding. We get along great. But I'm saying we do well inside the church. I think our weak point is loving those outside the church. And that's evidenced by the fact that we seldom reach out to them in the way that we should. I can prove that one to you. When is the last time you, as a member of this church, invited someone who is not your relative or next-door neighbor to join you in church? When is the last time we made an effort to reach out to that family, whoever or whatever the conditions or situation, whatever they may have been? How can we say that we love them if we've never made an effort to reach out to them? And so it all boils down to a question for all of us. Are we really concerned about other people? Really concerned? Do we really love them? Let me give you another personal illustration. Now, someone said, they say preacher ought not to say he's going to give a personal illustration if it didn't happen to him. But this one happened to me also. We've had different people living in the houses out front that are now rental houses. Several years ago, we had a young couple living in the old parsonage. Did you live there, John Penny?
I existed there.
You existed there. Oh, that's okay. It looked like to me you made it okay, to tell you the truth. But anyway, they lived in the house next in the parsonage. I was over there one day out in the yard. I don't know what I was doing. But probably out there at that sign or something, putting some letters up, he came out. The young man came out. I don't remember what his name was. I honestly don't. They're not there now because they moved on. But he came out to where I was, and I said something to him that I'd like to invite you to church sometime. Now, some of you heard part of this story. He said, I can't come to your church. I said, why can't you? These are his words. He said, you don't have anything but millionaires coming to your church. I said, now maybe you know the congregation better than I do, you know. But I don't think all of them are really millionaires, you understand. But he said, no, I can't come to your church. I tried to persuade him that he could, and as far as I know, they never came. Except about a year and a half ago, there was a funeral in this room, and that couple who now live in Fredericksburg came to that funeral, walked up to me after the service. I'd used the story about the dash in the funeral service. They came up to me and told me how much that story meant to them, and they'd really like to come to church here sometime, but they haven't gotten here yet. But anyway, Now, where did the boy get his information? What brought him to that conclusion that only millionaires came to this church? Now, I don't think he came in here and looked around. I don't think he saw what you were wearing or whatever, because he never came to a service. Maybe came over and drove through the parking lot, you know, and saw all those nice cars out there and said, these people must all be millionaires or something. I don't know. I don't know where he got his information. And it really wasn't information. It was just an excuse is what it was. But here's what I want you to hear me say this morning. It really doesn't matter if we're all millionaires or not. You know what matters? It matters what people perceive us to be. And that's the people who visit here. They look around. They say, you know, they're this, that, or the other. Well, how do people see us? Now, we're different. And don't worry, I've asked Marky if I can use this illustration. You ladies here this morning, Marky is the only woman in this church that wears a hat to church. Now, every one of you turning around to stand up, Marky, so they can see you. And so she's the only one in this church that wears a hat to church. No, I'm sorry, Judy. I'm sorry, Judy. You've blown my cover. You've blown my cover. But anyway. But what I'm saying is this. If people look around and say, oh, all the women over there, all the women go to that church wear hats, then that's just an excuse. Or the men, every man in that church had a coat and tie on, and I can't go to that church if I've got to wear a coat and tie. I deliberately didn't wear a coat and tie this morning so that I could use this in my sermon, you understand. I told Webster Sanders, I said, Webster, ever since I've been here, you've had a coat and tie on, usually a white shirt and a matching tie and everything, and I was going to use him in the sermon, and guess what? He's got a black shirt on this morning, and so I think Webster's backsliding or something in his. But here's what I'm saying. You see, how do people come to these conclusions? They come to these conclusions because this is their perception. Now, let me use another illustration. Some of you listen to Charles Stanley, don't you, on the television? Do you? Yeah, you do. Now, Charles is going to walk out there, and what's he going to have on? What's he going to have? He's going to have a coat and tie, and they're all matching, and I don't know who picked them out for him, but he's going to have a coat and tie and all that. I've never seen him on television that he hasn't done this. And this is an aside. This is a bragging point. In every church I've served, Charles Stanley has always preached for me, except Cobham Park. Then he got too old to do it, and so he couldn't get him to come to Warsaw. But anyway, but Charles has a son that's a preacher also. Do you know that? Charles preaches at the First Baptist Church in Atlanta, and he'll probably have 3,000 or 4,000 people in his congregation this morning. His son preaches across town. You know what Andy Stanley would be wearing in his church this morning? A pair of blue jeans, his shirt tail hanging out, probably a pair of tennis shoes or something like that, and he's going to preach to 10,000 people today. Now, what am I saying to you? I'm saying to you, different strokes for different folks. Does it really matter whether Marky and Judy wear a hat or not? Some of you women used to wear hats, right? Right. That's fine. I want to keep doing it. If we can't find the offering plates one Sunday, I want to borrow them. It's all perception. It's all perception. And what I'm saying is that we somehow, let me say this. I preached 30 years and 1 month at the Downtown Baptist Church in Alexandria. Not once, in 30 years did I ever wear anything but a suit, a white shirt, and a tie. And downtown was not an upscale church. I mean, I preached to congressmen and street people in the same service. So it was that kind of situation. But you see, it's what people perceive us to be. And if they perceive us that, you know, we're all white tie and suit people or hat people, then that's their perception. But some of the rest of you, you feel comfortable. I don't believe Richard even has a necktie, to tell you the truth. If he bought it last week or sometime or another. But anyway, we need to be comfortable in ourselves. Am I making sense to you this morning? And here's what I'm trying to say to you. If the church, you know, is going to love those outside of the church, we've got to let them know that we care about them. And if they come to this church, they're not going to have to wear a suit and a tie and things like, and the women won't, pardon me, they won't have to wear a hat if they want to come to church here, you know. I'm saying that the church that's going to grow in the future and be the church that God wants us to be, then we've got to be the people that God wants us to. We've got to let the people out there know that we care about them. Do you know what Eddie, I don't think he told you this in the sermon, but I've been with Eddie in some meetings, and this guy's been to more meetings than anybody should have to go to. But he has told me this, based on their studies and acknowledgement in the headquarters in Richmond, 25 years from now, only a few Baptist churches will exist on the Northern Neck. They will cease to exist as a functioning church. Now, the building might be here and the cemetery might be here, but as far as preaching to people and witnessing to people, it simply won't happen. And here's what I want you to hear me say. Something else they're also saying. That the church of the future is going to be a different color. And I'm not talking about the paint of the walls. I'm talking about the faces of the peoples that sit in that church. And in the days to come, we're either going to have to deal with this and reach out to whosoever will, or we're going to go the route that Eddie Heath has warned us about. We began by talking about a healthy, growing church. And I want to leave you with this. A healthy, growing church is a church that loves people in and outside of the church. That's the sermon. Now, thanks to my assistant, Miss Angie Sanders, she has helped me to illustrate this for you this morning. And Steve Green, who is a wonderful, wonderful musician, is going to sing for you a wonderful, wonderful song. Forget all about the sermon. Tiny, it went over a minute, and I'm sorry, and I'll apologize for that. But don't you forget this song, because this is why we're here, and this is why we're going to be back next Sunday, to love God, to love those in and outside of the church. And there's a reason for that.
I can see it in their eyes. Empty people filled with care, headed who knows where. On they go through private their silent cries. Only Jesus hears. People need the Lord.
Why everything I've said to you this morning is true? Because people need the Lord. Amen. My Jesus, I love you. I know you're mine. It's our closing hymn. There are just two or three verses we'll sing. But it's our closing commitment hymn. If God speaks to your heart about giving your heart to Him or to becoming a part of this church, whatever, whatever. We stand, we sing it together, please. I'm asking a favor of you to be seated for just a moment, please. A couple of weeks ago, a member of this church called the office here and said, add my name to the prayer list. He had been diagnosed with cancer and wanted his church family to pray for him. I met with Carrington Mother's Head after that call, and we had a wonderful talk, and we prayed together, and he's had some tests since then. I said, Carrington, sometimes when people are like this, we call them to the front, and we gather the deacons, and we just have a prayer session over you. I said, when you feel like you'd like to do that or be willing to do that, we'll be glad to do it. Carrington walked up to me. He's been back to the doctor, by the way. He walked up to me this morning. He said, I'm ready for that if you want to do it today. I'm going to ask, come on, Carrington. Carrington has been diagnosed with bone cancer. And he said, you're getting treatments, Carrington? You're getting treatments?
I'm scheduled for some special shots, and I'm waiting for the insurance company to approve it.
Okay. I'm going to invite and the deacons who are here, family members, you're here. Marty, you up there. Tyler, you over here. If you want to join us, you're perfectly. But come on and join me. We're just going to gather. Put the chair here, Jimmy, and let Carrington sit down. Now, for those of you who are visiting, don't worry. We're not going to pull out any snakes, anything like that while you were here. But we're going to pray for Carrington Mother's Head. Okay? A prayer of faith. And if we can, get around him, in behind him, beside him, over here, so that you have a hand on someone who is here this morning. Gary is coming. I'm waiting for him. Carrington shared his testimony with me as he sat at our table that night. And he joined this church some years ago, but he said he remembered some kind of meeting they had at Monocan Baptist Church, right, Carrington? A revival meeting at Monocan Baptist Church. After that, and he said, as I sat there that night, I opened my heart and I gave my heart to Jesus. And he's here as a follower of Jesus and a Christian, and he's facing some tough times perhaps. But not alone, okay? Not alone. Ron Prohodo, I'm going to call on several of you just to lead in the prayer. But will you begin our prayer, Ron? We won't be here until 2 o'clock up. But if we are, that's okay. You're going home. We're going to keep praying. Okay, Ron.
Dear Lord, we thank you for your love for us. We thank you for your healing power. You've demonstrated so many times. Not only in the Bible, but even in the congregations which I've been a part. We pray right now that you will be with Carrington and you will lay your healing hand on him. As we as representatives lay our hands on him, may you bring healing through us from your power that can do all things. And we give you the thanks and the praise.
Wallace, as our chairman, will you lead us in prayer, please?
Gracious Heavenly Father, I've known this man for many years. We work together. Sometimes even played together. He's a good man. And I just pray that your healing power will come about his body and give him life more abundant.
Father, we stand here as a body of faith this morning, believing in you, loving our friend Carrington, who has served you in this church for a number of years. He's here this morning with health issues, but we believe that you're the great physician. And in the name of Jesus this morning, because we're convinced that Carrington will give you the praise for it when it happens, we commit him to you for your healing hand, for your love, your care, your blessings, that it will be a testimony in this community and even beyond as to the God that you are. And everybody in the congregation said, Amen. 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 God bless you, Karen.
Thank you. I want to say a couple more.
Go ahead.
I thank you for all of the prayers that y'all already have given me. I was in Richmond last week and had a bone scan, and there are no cancer in my my spine. Thank you. There was no cancer in my spine, and I don't have any cancer in any of my organs. It's just in the bones themselves. And by not having it in the spine, that was a big thought in mind, that prayer had already been answered in that. I love you all, and I know that all of you have been praying for me. Thank you so much for continuing my prayers.